By the way, Natasha, who is your audience?
I would love to reach the young people, my children's generation, those who are, you know, in their early 30s and in 20s and maybe the 18 onwards, 18 to their mid 30s. That would be wonderful. But also for my generation, my age group, who were there during the war. It's good. I think it's good to have context for ourselves, for our children of Uganda, where we are coming from, you know, and where our journey, where we are headed. But it's good to know where we come from. Mm. A lot of the young children born now I feel like they don't have context to our history.
Those from among you, what a title. What inspired the title?
The Bible verse, yeah, from Isaiah 58, I believe. It says, those from among you will rebuild the old waste places and restore the streets to dwell in, and you'll be called the repairers of the breach. Repairer of the breach, yeah. So this is really a story of Uganda, but it's also a story of Uganda, but it follows the NRM, and President Museveni, from when he was young, you know, into their time for NASA, the NRA, and, you know, onwards. So basically it talks about those from among you means, you know, the Mzee, and those who believe the vision with him, who gave up so much to fight for what they didn't have an assurance of, you know. So people see them from this side of history, but at that time it was, you know, like how the Bible talks about faith. Abraham went to a place he did not know, you know. So they had a faith and a hope in what Uganda could be, and they went on that. So that's what the story is about.
What lessons would you like the audience to pick out of the documentary?
I was hoping that people would also see that at least at school, I learned a lot about the time of colonialism and so on. But I would want people to know that before that, we had, you know, organized societies in Africa and in this part of the Great Lakes, and, you know, clans and just organized societies. Sadly, those societies did not, they didn't strengthen themselves. They stayed kind of like in small groups, and that's how come I believe that when the foreigners came, they could rule, because the people were not strong. They're all small groups, and then, you know, so we were not. I would want people to know that we had the colonialism. I wish that it didn't define us so much, you know. We were a people before the coming of the colonialists. However, when we came together, now that we became one nation, we should understand that there is strength in numbers. This is what I believe the NRM and Mzee has preached about from the time the NRM came to power in 1986, about let's be stronger, let's come together, let's make the East African this, let's, you know. So I would wish that they would see the journey. I wish people can see the journey of the NRM, understand some of our history, even though we don't go as in-depth into it as we should, say pre-colonial and so on.
What do you think of Uganda's film industry?
I think it will go places. I think now that Ugandans are finding their own way of, like, the authentic way of telling, doing films. What I don't like is when Africans make films as if using like European plots and European language, and you know, as if just using Africans but telling like Mzungu stories, kind of talking like them. And I don't, that's, but now I see that the Ugandans are starting to make really very authentic stories. I see Kenyans are doing it as well, and that for me, that's, I think that's great. Mm-hmm. I think we have so much history, whether we go in history, whether we tell contemporary stories. There's no continent on earth that has that depth of culture and beauty and like literature and poetry that we have here in Africa. So I wish that we can tap into that.
What advice would you give to a younger film producer?
Now, I think the world is changing and technology has changed a lot of things. So I think now, if you have the creativity, you have that gift, I believe you can really, all you need, if you have a smartphone and you have, you know, I think it's a little bit easier now than it was years ago to access an audience, because I think a lot of the time what people want is a market, you know, where who will watch what I'm doing, who will. So I would say just do it, just start and see where that takes you. I'm sure many of the people who are actually in the film industry who are doing well, that's how they started, by just, you know, give it a shot, and then hopefully it will take you somewhere.
Would you consider writing for children again?
I would love to, because I do love writing. And at that time I had wanted to follow it with a boys comic. That one was really for girls. And then I just got distracted, I'm sure, in other things. But it's something I would really like to do. Mm. For us to have our own heroes, you know, our own characters that our children can relate to.
What challenges, if any, have you faced in the industry?
I haven't really found any challenges. Maybe not being able to reach everybody I'd want to reach in terms of for interviews and, you know, and such. But otherwise, by God's grace, it has been, God has been with us, blessed us, and it has been a peaceful endeavor.
What lessons would you want the youth to learn from the documentary?
We do have a big young population, so I feel if our young Ugandans can have a spirit of patriotism, to love Uganda, and I don't know what it takes to inculcate that into a child. I don't know, because for me personally, with my own children, we just talk to them a lot about our history, and you know, we have a lot of communication with them, and that has made them aware and awakened to our place in on the continent, in the story of Africa, and all that. And if we hadn't, then there's a lot of, there's so much other information, and there's so much distraction for this young generation. So I think if we could somehow focus on patriotism, for people to, if we love our country, then we are really all stakeholders in it. Because anything that goes wrong affects this land, which is for us. Huh?
You have grown up in the house of one of Africa's greatest freedom fighters, and by infection, you must have picked some political maneuvers from the old man with a hat. Would you consider taking up a political job if appointed, or through elections?
Wow, I don't think he would, though. I don't think it would ever cross his mind. A political career. There's a saying, never say never. But I think having grown up in that, personally, me, having grown up in that household, seeing my parents and their level of commitment and service and sacrifice, which I feel people never just really understand it. I genuinely don't think that I it's a level of, that I have, that self, to like leave the many things that you'd want to do, for me, I'm talking for myself.
Yes.
So no, I don't think so, because I see it truly, I see politics as service. So your time is not your own, you must always be someplace all the time, so I don't think so.
What do you consider as the biggest challenge in Uganda today, given the fact that 78% of the country's population is youthful?
We have so much, I also hate the word potential in Uganda, you know? Like it's been, potential must be realized at some point, but we have land that yields, you can plant things and harvest them, and you know, so I don't know, I would love to see the us young people take advantage of all the blessings that are in Uganda on this land, you know.
How has this documentary impacted your career?
Perhaps maybe that is where this, the deep love for Uganda comes from, and for Africa. Maybe perhaps it comes from walking with, being close to Mzee and Mama. That is what, if among many other things, one of the big things I have gotten from them is that, like really deep respect for, love for this country and for this continent and for the people of the continent. When I've traveled with, for example, Mzee, he'll always, in Africa especially, he'll always talk to people, whether it's someone driving a car, what, he'll talk to him, where are you from? And the person will say, oh, I'm from, I don't know, this, I'm Kosa or something like this, you know. He says, how do you greet them? He says, like this. He says, you see, that's the same for us. We greet the people of this area in Uganda, so we're the same. He's always looking for that unifying factor everywhere, on this continent at least. So for me, I think, those are things that I have picked up from my parents, and those are things that I would love to and I'm trying to instill in my own children. That's what I would wish for the youth of Uganda. You see, because Uganda is our only home, you can love and admire California or what, but that's it's somewhere else. Eh? So we need to work to make our home a place that we can live in, our children can live in, their children can live in. That's what patriotism is, I think. And for me, I think, and Pan-Africanism, love of Africa, love of, you know, love of one another as Africans.
And by the way, not discounting your parents, but tell us three influential people in your life, with the exception of your parents, that is.
My husband. Mm.
Three.
I'm blessed with the people whom I truly, truly, genuinely look up to are in my life. I mean, these are the people whom I have learned from, whom I have, you know. I'm actually, funny enough, interestingly, I'm someone who does that a lot. I go back, and my sister patients told me it's a characteristic of my nature. Going back to places. I always go back, physically. I travel back to places from my childhood, from wherever. I always actually go back physically to visit the places that I think impacted my life somehow. So, but as in where we lived when we were young in Sweden, like my hall in university, such places. I've always wanted to go back to where I was born, Moshi. I wanted to go back to Dar es Salaam, where we lived with my parents, because I remember that little flat. I wanted to go back to Nyeri, a boarding school up in the highlands there in Kenya, where my mom kind of took me from when we were going to exile. She couldn't tell the headmaster that she was taking me out of the school, because I think somehow they had refused. So she just said, yeah, let me just take her, we'll be back. Mm-hmm. And then there's a whole story of how I left my case there and everything. But I wanted to go back to places like that.
Okay.
Yeah.
So there's not a place.
I go back to visit the places that impacted my life, you know, But there's no season that I would want to like go back to. No, I think I am a believer. I am a follower of Jesus, and by His grace, He has He's with me in every season of my life. So every season that I am in, I'm thankful for it, even those which seem harder than others. I know that there's always a purpose for that, you know, and you just pray for the grace to get through it. Yeah, but I am thankful for every season. The typical day. I think it depends on what I'm doing. When I've been doing this documentary, you'll be filming, you'll be interviewing, you'll be either editing or things like that, you know.
Have a routine until I'm up by 7.
Yes, I'm up early and I sleep late because I think I just I like the night time when it's kind of quiet. But because the children are normally up early and my husband's up early every day, so I wake up early by 7. I'm up. I pray. I have my time. Then my children join me if they're home. Like now on holidays, they come and we just be together. Or I read, or I watch the news that I like, some account channels that I follow. Things like that, really. Mm. I love the village very much. I love the peace. It's like time slows down. Mm-hmm. And in fact, funny enough, I always tell people that when you're driving out of Kampala, it's like the time goes like slowing down, and then you get there, and then there's a...
This has been People and Stories. Thank you for viewing. See you next time. Bye-bye.